every once in a while.
A new technology,
an old problem,
and a big idea turns into innovation.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, the galaxies of intellectuals, invited guests, faculty members, and my dear friends. I, Rashi.
And I, Rishabh. On behalf of our entire VSID family, welcome you all to the junction of visual thinking of programmed minds.
It is rightly said that any sufficient advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. The technology we use impresses no one, but the experience we create with it is everything.
VSID presents MADHYAM, HR Conclave 2019. We at VIPS believe in encouraging the growing talent, and by MADHYAM, we bring to you the opportunities people to learn from, and a day full of intellect, unbound knowledge, and encouraging guidance. MADHYAM 19 gives you a platform where HRs of different organizations are gathered together to help you envision opportunities for the future and help you prosper. VIPS strives for one and all to get inspired, share knowledge, and look up to the future technology. MADHYAM 19 will be a vital step towards the fulfillment of VIPS' mission of man-making, character-building, nation-building, as espoused by Swami Vivekananda.
Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies strongly believes in its vision to establish, maintain, and promote center of excellence for imparting quality professional education comparable with the best in the world. To augment our vision further, we are here in front of you with our next edition of MADHYAM. Today, in this erudite gathering, we have with us Professor Dr. Ratan Sharma, Principal Director, WIPS.
Mr. Pankaj Mahindru, Chairman, India Cellular and Electronics Association. As the event has been coordinated by the students, they mistakenly referred to the wrong designation from the internet. We apologize for that, sir. We now request Sunit Vats, sir, to kindly felicitate Pankaj Mahindru, sir.
We welcome you, sir. We have Mr. Sandeep Bhargav, Executive Senior Vice President, Vodafone Idea Limited. We request Ratan Sharma, sir, to kindly felicitate, sir.
We welcome you, sir.
Mr. Arvind Bali, Advisor Connect Broadband, Infodart and Lipsa. Sir is also the ex-CEO of Videocon Telecom. We request our Dean Supriya Madan ma'am to kindly felicitate Arvind, sir. And we also welcome all the ambitious minds here.
Light and brightness have always been equated with positivity, motivation, and associated with spiritual beings. Light is a form and symbol of Tej. The lamp is invoked as Tamsoma Jyotirgame, meaning the lamp leads us from darkness towards light.
Deepa Jyoti Prarambha, Deepa Jyoti Janardhana, Deepo Meharatu Papam, Deepa Jyotir Namostate. Like every other auspicious occasion, let's start this event by offering our prayers to Ma Saraswati and conduct the customary lamp lighting ceremony as a tribute to Ma Saraswati, the embodiment of knowledge. We would like to invite all the dignitaries for the lamp lighting ceremony.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. We now request all the dignitaries to kindly get seated on the dais.
We welcome our very own Principal Director, Professor Dr. Ratan Sharma. Sir has a PhD in finance from University of Delhi. He has a rich experience of more than 40 years in the field of education and has worked at various prestigious institutes. Some of the elite institutes where Sir has worked include IIM Lucknow, Management Development Institute, Gurgaon, SP Jain Institute of Management and Research, Mumbai, where he served as Director of Center of Family Managed Businesses, Administrative Staff College of India, Hyderabad, and Balmim, where he was the founder director, a constituent of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. He was also worked as director of a business school in the private sector. Sir was also EFMD fellow in Manchester Business School, UK, and has worked on factors influencing abnormal returns on corporate equities in UK. Sir is a member of a number of professional bodies, and his expertise helps these institutes to provide quality and relevant management education. In addition, he was also a visitor's nominee in the Department of Commerce at Aligarh Muslim University, FMS of Delhi University. We request you, sir, to kindly share your views and address the gathering.
Good morning, friends. Friends, in fact, it's a pleasure and honor to extend a very hearty and warm welcome to begin with the illustrious panel of the speakers, including the chief guest that we got today. One of them, in fact, will be joining little late, Mr. Chandan Kumar. He will be joining late, but we are extremely happy to have our chief guest to begin with, Pankaj Mahindruji. He is a president and founder of very important association that must have seen it, Indian Cellular and Electronic Association. Please give a big hand to him. On behalf of the institute and on my own behalf, Pankaji, we are extremely happy to have you, and we extend a very hearty and warm welcome to you. We also have Mr. Sandeep Bhargav, who is the executive vice president of a very important telecom company, which is Vodafone Idea Limited. Now, he represents a very important experience from this, and he could spare time. We extend once again to have extend a hearty and warm welcome to him. Please give a big hand to him, to Sandeep Bhargavji. We also have amongst us Mr. Arvind Bali. He represents Videocon Telecom, indeed. He was currently advisor, but he was ex-CEO, therefore a very rich experience, in fact, in this industry. Sir, we extend a very hearty and warm welcome to you, sir, on behalf of the institute. Friends, it's a very special day today. We must extend a very hearty and warm welcome to our friends and colleagues, to begin with our own youthful, friendly vice chairman, who is Sunit Vats. Though he's a part of us, but I think this is important. We extend a hearty welcome to Mr. Sunit Vats. He could spare time be with us. He represents a new generation of thought leaders in the management and that stakeholders, which is really we are looking for, Mr. Sunit Vats. So it's very nice that you are here, Mr. Sunit, that you are representing from the side of management. Dr. Vats, he was here yesterday, but I must mention this journey which we have started. But before that, I must extend a hearty and warm welcome to my other colleagues, particularly the Dean VSIT, Supriya Madan, Anuradha Jain, who are currently present, and other colleagues senior. It will be very difficult to individually name it, but I think they are all very precious. They are very important for us to have this function, having it here. We extend a very hearty and warm welcome to each and every one of you. Of course, Divya is a part of the function, so I need not really welcome, because I, on her behalf, also welcome. And you as a student body, because without you, we could not have done anything at all. It is for you, by you, and of you. Therefore, you are doing it. We are only an instrument, in fact, in terms of doing it. But still, we should try to welcome you, and this is what we have done. I must mention, sir, to begin with, a journey that we have undertaken in the case of the WIFS. I'll take a few minutes, because we should start with what we are today. and from where we started. In 2000, this VIPS, Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies Institute, was set up, and we started with the law department, as our chairman was mentioning, because law is very important. This is what, and we'll show you that those, as on today, we got 6 departments. In fact, under the umbrella of VIPS, we got IT, we got a management, we got economics, we got English, we got a journalism, and of course, law, which remains a very important thing. So we got around 7,000 students as on today on the campus of VIPS. This is where we are flourished. We also have, other than that, around 300 faculty members who are representing the VIPS. This only a batch, we are saying only 180 or so students, because we could not have accommodated all 1,000 students. So we requested VSIT dean and other deans that please, you only have a select group of students and have them for maybe an interaction with such thought leaders from the industry, which is nice. This sort of a growth, sir, if I say so, is possible only when there is some leader who is a visionary in its approach, in its thinking, in its action. And that is what we found in Dr. S. Sivas. He is not present here. He met you. It was he, in fact, his idea that we should try to get into the education field, though he belonged to the field of medicine. He was a doctor himself, very practicing doctor, but he thought, no, let me get into the field of education. I read an interesting quote, sir, I must say at this stage. This was a 7th century quote, somebody gave it, that if you have a plan for 1 year, then plant rice. If you have a plan for 10 years, plant trees. But if you have a plan for 100 years, have an education for the children. And that is what 7th century BC, somebody, some scholar, some expert spoke on that. Probably this has led Dr. Vaz to get into the field of education. And that is being influenced by Swami Vivekananda philosophy. He started having that very interesting part of thing, which is man-making, character building, and nation building. These are 3 very important visionary aspects which he undertook. And he said, let's try not only to say it, but also implement it and do it. So I think that is what really represents the whole philosophy of Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies. As I mentioned it to you, that we got 7,000 students, but students are our pride. They in fact represent us, not only academically, they have achieved wonderfully great results. In IP University, we are the most preferred college in terms of the admissions that we are talking about in different courses that we are having it. They have also got the achievements academically. In fact, if you see, we'll show you later, in fact, once we are through, they have achieved, in fact, top grade. In fact, they have a topper in the university of IP University in almost in all the years from different departments. Not only that, after the education part is over, they have also been a very good achievers in their practical life, and they have been in the field of judiciary. They've got in the judiciary services. In the army also, same thing. Not only in the law, but also in the case of the IT and others, they have reached a certain stage where we can feel proud of it. In fact, we feel very happy. Please give a big hand to our student body, which is what wonderfully done. I won't be taking much time, but I must say this, that today's conference, which is the conclave that we have organized, which is what we are saying is MADHYAM, it's a mantra. HR Conclave Mantra, the name we have given, 2019. Mantra is something you look at it, you adopt it, use it, and then you try to have the results. So we thought it that for IT, yesterday we have it for the management students, that we said it munch, it was a platform. But here is a MADHYAM, through this MADHYAM something has to be achieved. That is what we named it. Simple, I think, philosophy we had in our mind, that IT is something which is instrumental in making us very successful in the today's world of business. I think it's very simple that way. IT is instrumental. IT is a medium through which we can really try to achieve success. And this is what we are saying, that in the business today, what you are finding in this business, in which we were having business, in fact, say 10 years ago, is a totally different business, which is there's a disruption which has taken place. So it's a disrupting stage, which is IT which has done it. And disruption for the good, for the bad, I think there can be opinion, but one thing is you can't close your eyes to the disruption which is taking place, the use of IT which is there. We as an academic institution also, we are also trying to review ourselves, sir, what are we doing, what we teach, and how we are teaching it, both the contents part and also the pedagogy part, the way we are teaching it. Are we adding value to our students or to the society or not? So we thought it, how really to go about it. Now, our faculty colleagues, they try to discuss, we try to have a lot of brainstorming sessions, what is that we should do, but also I think nothing really speaks better than we have an interaction with what we say the industry. And therefore, we thought it, let's try to talk to the industry people, what do they feel, and what is that we should be doing it. Because generally this has been found that what we teach in the classroom is sometimes there's a gap in what is the industry looks for. Now, if there is a gap, then what is that gap? We do not know. We try our best. And I will give you one example which I gave yesterday also. I was in IIM Lucknow, and this was in 87-86. So how many years? You can see. At that time, there was a thinking simple that what we are teaching in IIM and what is required by the industry, there's a big gap at that time in 87, right? Today also, the same thing is being repeated every day, right? There's a gap between what we teach in the classroom and what the industry looks for. It is not that academicians don't try to fill in the gap. It's not that. Don't take it that way as a student body, that we are lethargic, we don't do anything. No, our own colleagues, we are very much in touch with what is happening in the industry. We try to fill in the gap also. We do our best. But it seems the industry is changing so fast that we are not able to keep pace with what is happening, right, in the classroom. That is what is happening. So industry is changing very fast. Therefore, what we look for it, let's try to talk to the industry people. What is that we should do? It's not only the contents part. It is not only the knowledge part, but also the pedagogy, the way we should be teaching them. Because ultimately, this becomes very important thing that we should try to get into this part of the way we teach. Therefore, we thought it we should have HR conclave with the name which we say the mantra. And this is a madhyam through which we'll come to know in order to reduce the gap. So three, four things we are thinking about it. Number one is a knowledge gap, if there is, and which is there, I'm sure. Knowledge gap between what we teach in the classroom and what is required. Secondly, skill gap. What we try to inculcate the skill among the students and what the industry looks for, in fact, in the real world. So that I think it's ultimately what we look for, a good job, good work, good employment, good opportunities for our own students. Third thing is the value system which we really look for it. What the industry looks for, what we do it. Maybe academically we feel a certain type of value system, but maybe industry looks for another thing. Maybe they're the same, there's absolutely nothing. But maybe we teach in a very different way. Learning is in a different way. How we try to cope up with the situation which is really happening. So it is with this in mind, we thought it we should try to organize this HR conclave with the name which will be given to Madhyam, because business in any way is drastically changed over a period of time. And this is for you guys as students. What we are referring to today is the Industrial Revolution 4.0, which means, and this revolution is nothing but IT revolution in the field of business, wherein in the domain knowledge which you are talking about, the artificial intelligence, the IoT you are talking about, Internet of Things, you are talking about deep learning, machine learning, and what not. You are talking about everything. Everywhere you are there. Jaise kehte na, jahan na pahuncha kabhi, jahan na pahuncha kabhi, wahan jahan na pahuncha Ravi, wahan pahuncha kabhi. Aur jahan na pahuncha kabhi, wahan pahunche ye IT ke log. Kyunki aapko sab dekh rahe hain. Aap kya kar rahe hain? What are you doing it? Anything, everything what you are doing is, in fact, they are capturing it. So even every profile is being captured by these people, and they let me know, Dr. Sharma, you were there. I say, I was, yes, I was, but I didn't tell anybody. But they come to know about it. This is how what is happening it. So since you are a student of IT yourself, I won't be talking much about it, but I won't be merely mentioning that I think some of the issues that we are concerned today are the type of skill set required, and I think they are the best people really to talk about it, because the people they really hunt for go for it. The type of things which are there in India, which we look for it, and therefore their own experiences in this field. So with this, I once again extend a very hearty and warm welcome to everyone, those present here on the panel. I'm sure it will be very rich, enriching experience to every one of you, both professionally and personally. And if that is done, make it more interactive. I'm sure you will enjoy the session which is going to be there. With this, thank you very much indeed for everything that is there. So nice of you.
Thank you so much, sir, for that very humble start.
Today, we feel honored to have with us such an esteemed panel of dignitaries who have spared their valuable time to bless us with their knowledge and guidance. We welcome our chief guest, Mr. Pankaj Mahindru. Sir is the chairman of India Cellular and Electronics Association, the apex body of mobile industry in India. He is the chairman of the special task force set up by the Department of Electronics and Information Technology, Government of India, to transform India's mobile and electronics manufacturing ecosystem in order to boost domestic manufacturing, contribute to Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi's ambitious Make in India program, and to minimize India's import dependency in the field. Sir is also the founder and honorary secretary of Telecom Sector Skill Council, a not-for-profit body set up jointly by the Cellular Operations Association of India. India Cellular Association and Telecom Centers of Excellence under the aegis of National Skill Development Council. Sir is also the chairman and publisher of My Mobile, India's number one print and online magazine in the mobile sector.
We welcome Mr. Sandeep Bhargav, EVP Corporate Affairs and Public Policy. Sir is an experienced executive vice president with a demonstrated history of working in the telecommunications industry, skilled in 3G, 4G, LTE, innovation management, government and mobile communications. Sir has a strong advocacy, policy, external relations, countrywide, states, overseas, and is a business development professional. Sir is a member, Executive Council PECOSA, National Advisory Board Member, Sarthak Educational Trust, and Vice President, National Olympics Association of India.
We welcome Mr. Arvind Bali, Advisor Connect Broadband, Infodart, and Lipsa. Sir is also the ex-CEO of Videocon Telecom. Sir is an accomplished business leader with more than 35 years of expertise in management of various business streams with globally respected outcomes. Sir possesses capabilities of transforming underperforming organizations with powerful analytical skills, potent communication capability, and strategic vision. As a corporate executive, Arvind Sir possesses extensive expertise across most markets in Asia, US, and Europe, handling various business verticals, including new business development, international sales and operations, international restructuring, value creation, introduction of new products, and leveraging global supply chain.
It is rightly said the foundation stones for a balanced success are honesty, character, integrity, and faith. And we hold in great respect for a true amalgamation of these with us today. We would request Mr. Pankaj Mahindru, sir, to address the gathering and to guide us and inspire us to be more than what we are today.
Good morning, friends. I'm honored to be here. You know, you should be very proud of the fact that you are in IT academics, because I did my MBA from FMS in 1983, and I had the privilege, you know, that my family could afford foreign travel in 70s and 80s. When we would go to a foreign country, you know, Indians were very looked down upon. For example, if you were in Europe, you would want to enter a jewelry store, they won't open the door for you. We used to face the same thing in Hong Kong. The only country which sort of respected Indians to some extent was Russia. Everywhere else we were, you know, considered to be a country of snake charmers, etc. This image of India has changed because of the IT professional. And I think we should all cheer to that at least in one vertical, this country has reached global standards. So you are very privileged that you are going to be IT professionals, something which India is so proud of. I will not be esoteric. I'll try to be very, you know, simple and tell you some hard facts, I think, which you should all know. And the idea is to, in a way, to try and inspire you and also tell you what are the infirmities of our system and, you know, where it has landed us. while I said that, you know, the IT professional has done so well, when you visit San Francisco, the Bay Area, and you enter a restaurant, you know, it seems you are in Bangalore or Delhi, you know, and there are restaurants where you'll just hear Telugu language being spoken, and so it's very uplifting. But let me give you some very hard facts. India's per capita income was more than China in 1990, I think before most of you were born. And it was in fact more than even Korea and you know, other Far East countries. Today, India's per capita income is 1/5 of China. So in these 28 years, while China started growing like this, India's growth was like this. So something's gone wrong, that in every industry, in every trade, barring probably IT, we have been sort of left behind. And 1/5 is a very stark thing, you know. Something happening in 28 years is a very stark thing. And so who's responsible for it? I think all of us are responsible for this. And I feel particularly, you know, very responsible, because this has happened in my generation when, you know, we were in the work age. This is what has happened. So I contemplate, you know, I sort of agonize about it. And then my mind goes back to 1990, when I actually visited China for the first time. And I was telling your principal director and the chairman that, so I decided to go to a factory and to a primary school. And when I went to the factory, it was about 10:45. Chinese eat very early, so their lunch is around 11:30. Their breakfast is at 7, and you know, their dinner is at 5:30. These are the work hours. This is how they eat. So when I asked them what is their, how happy they are, and you know, what is their desire, in the factory everybody was very happy and they had no aspiration, there was no turnover, they were very happy with life. And in the primary school, every child gave me a different aspiration. A girl said, I want to be a doctor. So there was another gentleman, small, these were all kids 8, 9, 10 years old. And they all said basketball players, somebody wanted to be an engineer. But when I said, what is your greatest desire? Every child said the same thing in different ways, that we want China to be the most powerful nation in the world. I think that was the one, you know, differentiating factor, that it was imbibed in the children that you have to take this country forward. And the great leader Deng Xiaoping, when he opened China, this was 78-79. So in 1990, I just saw the beginning of the growth. It was still a very poor country, but we saw the beginning of the growth. So his 5-point program, which was rural enterprises, you know, opening the country to the world and making China the global manufacturing hub, were the few things which he did which made China such a powerful economy. This is almost a $12 trillion economy compared to $2.8 trillion. So I think there is a great responsibility which we have towards changing this whole thing and taking India to a different trajectory. The Prime Minister had called us about, in fact, last week, a group of 14 people, mostly from the digital industry, from IT services, from BPO services, from software, from electronic manufacturing. And his basic thought was that, you know, let's call it the digital industry. I think that's broadly what it is, because it's very difficult to call it information technology only now, because it's become more of a digital industry. So the Prime Minister felt that the digital industry, you know, permeates every part of trade, industry, human life, personal life, you know, family life. And So the responsibility on the digital industry is far greater, and it can take India to a different trajectory. And he gave a beautiful example, which was not esoteric. His communication is very basic, but very strong, fundamentally strong. He gave the example of Surat. He said, Surat is a big economy. There is so much diamond polishing there. But he says, is that enough? Is diamond polishing enough? India should aspire to design jewelry and to be the world leader in jewelry and not only in polishing. So the basic message was that, you know, we are very proud of the IT industry that we've been able to do so much, processing and so on. We're working for others. And I think Indian companies like Wipro, Infosys, TCS are highly respected because they are very ethical companies. They do very complex projects for global companies, very, very complex projects. But nobody's ever heard that a design of a supercomputer has been leaked out or anything like that has happened. These companies do amazing, very high-tech work, but they are very ethical companies, very ethical companies. And I'll speak a bit about ethics and spirituality since we are so inspired by Swami Vivekananda. So the message which the Prime Minister gave and which we firmly believe in is that we must move up the value chain. That is very important. And that innovation will have to come from people like you. Because you see, the large corporations are straitjacketed. Imagine a TCS or a Infosys or a Wipro, which already has massive contracts with global giants. So for them to compete by making their own products with their customers is not ethical. Wo kehte hai na, dono haath mein laddu nahi hote. So if you are in the contracting business, can you be in the business of creating products? It's a difficult one. So the disruptor is going to be innovators like you guys. There was a mention of electronic manufacturing here. So let me inspire you a little about what India has been able to achieve. In 2014-15, we had just two factories of mobile phones in the country. And we were producing about 58 million mobile phones. The global market is about 2 billion phones. So 2,000 million phones are made in the world. And we were producing 58 million. Now this year, we will be manufacturing 290 million phones, and which is a value of 1,65,000 crores. And between mobile phones and components, we have 268 plants. So this is what has happened now. Now what about the value add? The objective was to build a massive world-class industry, and we are not happy with 290 million. The next target is 500 million, and the target after that is 1 billion phones. The Prime Minister announced in June that India will be the number one mobile phone manufacturing country in the world. Now look at that, look at the vision and the audaciousness of that statement. Because although we are now number two in the world, but we are 12% of the world's manufacturing. And China is 75%. And the Prime Minister, that's why, you know, sometimes people say ki ye inka jumla hota and so on. But he sincerely believes in it that India will go up to become number one, so which means that China will have to go down because China can't stay at 75%. If we have to, we capture 50%, so China will have to be at 40%, and you know there will be other countries. Vietnam is still 10%. So there will be countries like Indonesia, etc., which will also start producing. Can this happen? Can such an audacious thing happen? And then I'll tell you the big opportunities which for people like you, because obviously you are not going to be in factories producing phones. Those will be people, you know, rural girls and boys who have just done 10th class or 12th class, they will be producing phones and there'll be millions of jobs added at that level. But I'll come later to, you know, what is in it for you. So this kind of a churn, why is it going to happen? You see, there are, as Swami Vivekananda also said, there are cosmic forces, you know. Now, 1990, I told you the story of the factory I went to. Now, when you go to a Chinese factory, you find them restless, you know. In 1990, if a Chinese worker was earning 10,000 rupees, he was sending 9,000 rupees back to his family because food was free, stay was free. Today, it's very different. Today, the turnover, I was telling your principal director that when I asked them what is the turnover of people, which means how many people are leaving every year, they didn't understand it because nobody ever left. You know, after the factory had been set, only one person had left that factory, and there were 25,000 workers in that factory. So just imagine, in 4 years, only one person had left. Today, when I asked, I don't want to name the company, but it's the largest company in the world in manufacturing. I said, what is your turnover? He said, 8%. I said, that's very high. He said, no, it's 8% per month. Okay? So what does it tell you? And they are restless because they have become wealthy. You know, their incomes are five times our incomes. The average worker there is earning about 60,000, 70,000 rupees equivalent. And a lot of workers there go and buy iPhone. They have become very self-centered. The whole system has changed because they become wealthy. So how manufacturing moved from Europe to United States, because United States had the big market, big population, big number of workers, and then it moved to Japan. Japan was a small country. It didn't have that much manpower. So it quickly moved to Korea, Taiwan, and also moved to the Far East, and then to China. Now, China is a giant country, so manufacturing has stayed there. You know, it's a massive manufacturing economy. So this is India's opportunity, because in this journey, what we've seen in the last 4 years, what I told you, how mobile manufacturing has become so big in India, although it is still about 12% of the world, how it has become so big. There is a myth that Indians don't produce good quality and they are not productive. This is not true. In the first 2-3 months when our mobile phone manufacturing factories were being set up, you know, our productivity was very low. But within 3 months to 6 months, the productivity became on par with China. Today, we are beating China on every parameter of productivity. And I'm talking about core manufacturing. You all know that in IT services, in software, in coding, Indians are par excellence. But I'm telling you about core manufacturing, right? On the same line where we are producing 2,000 phones, smartphones in China, the Indian equivalent plants are producing 2,500 to 26 with the same workforce. So Indians are more productive. The theory which we say is that, you know, we have PhDs, poor, hungry, and desirous people. That hunger is converting into productivity. And we are finding that. So I think this big thrust of manufacturing in electronics is going to happen here. Right, and I'll encourage you all to read a document called the National Policy on Electronics 2019, which is, you know, I'm going to keep talking about electronics because I want your focus to move away a little bit from outsourcing jobs and so on. That, you know, this is a big thing which is happening now. The National Policy on Electronics has a vision, obviously. The Prime Minister said that you should be number one in mobile phone manufacturing. So that's one strong vision, which is that our manufacturing target, I just told you a very impressive figure of 1,65,000 crores is what we are going to produce this year. The target for 2025 is about 13 lakh crores, and most of them is exported. When I was, my introduction was being given, you know, I felt a little upset because it talked about import substitution. we are no longer talking about import substitution. We are a very confident manufacturing country now. We are a very confident nation because we've seen the productivity gains. Because we are more productive and all the ecosystems in the world are coming here, we are now talking about exports of $110 billion. That's about 7.5-8 lakh crores of exports of mobile phones from India, which is the most cutting edge electronic product in the world, right? So has India arrived in electronic manufacturing? Yes, it has. Is value addition enough? No, it is not. Is there sufficient amount of R&D and design being done? No, it is not. So now I come to your opportunity. When this $400 billion worth of electronics is going to be produced, which is now happening, and with the trend which has started in mobile phones, we will create a lot of testing jobs, we'll create a lot of design jobs, right? And design in mobile phones is not only what you do on AutoCAD. That is, you know, so there are 4 or 5 designs when you do a mobile phone. A mobile phone has approximately 38 technologies and sciences in it. You know, there is electrical because you have a charger. Of course, you know, there is a lot of electronics in it. There is a lot of software engineering in it. So everything you will think of, there is a lot of electrochemistry in it and so on. So the design element will be, of course, there's going to be a lot of software engineering in the smartphone. I think the greatest event in this century was on 29th June 2007, when the iPhone was launched. I think that has changed our life completely. And quickly after that, Android followed. By the end of 2007, 2008, we had beta versions of Android. So in these 10 years, our life has completely changed. Every part of business, trade, personal life is a part of that. And, you know, we used to communicate as children to pen friends in Korea and Finland and US. Now, you know, with Facebook and social media stuff, imagine how empowered life has become. So, but coming back to design, I think software design, which is a part of the mobile phone design, and industrial design, mechanical design, and electronic design. None of you are electronic engineers, but the software engineering of the mobile phone and the application development is a very, very big area which India is now going to promote, right? I'll just give you a number, it'll startle you. Just iPhone, the iStore, paid $17 billion to developers in China in the last 4 years. This is the amount of money which goes in app development. So software engineering, which is for the mobile industry, our estimate is that as we are going up the value curve and the design starts in India, you know, a lot of global companies like Samsung and others have design in India, R&D in India, but they are not controlling the entire product. And when I went to the Samsung headquarter in Korea, guess which was the cuisine which I enjoyed the most? Indian. There's an Indian restaurant in the Samsung headquarters because there are 500 software engineers creating the most cutting edge smartphones in the world. They have a center in Bangalore, which has about 10,000 people, and Noida, and they have a, the project managers are all in Korea, these 500, the elite force of these guys. Absolutely exhilarating when you see that happening, you know. And when you see the Koreans enjoying the Indian food, it's even more encouraging. So this industry, the design industry, both software and application development, is a very, very lucrative industry for people like you in the next 5 years. So please look beyond IT services, please look beyond software, and look at this. And it's also a bit easier and a bit more creative. You know, if you're developing applications, if you're, of course, software engineering for mobile phone is extremely technical and it requires, you know, similar skills. And India is very, very strong in that. Now, I told you I'll be talking a bit about ethics and so on. You know, when we look at employees, human beings have normally four bodies, you know, the physical body, the mental body, the spiritual body, and the intellectual body. So when we look at people, I think these four have to be very well balanced. And I think we have been sort of receding in our spiritual wealth as a nation, as institutions, as corporates. And when you benchmark with the US, which is the largest economy in the world with $17 trillion of GDP, you see that the spiritual content, the charitable content in that country, in the corporates and in people is far more. I think that's the one reason why, you know, everything is very straightforward and not convoluted. So I'd like to leave that thought with you. The other thought which, you know, when we are doing this self-analysis, you know, we are doing a lot of self-analysis these days. Some of them initiated by the Prime Minister because he's very restless. He said one thing, you know, he was in the middle of elections and he found time to meet. This was his own initiative. And he said, my second term, I am going to begin first day ground running. You know, last time I didn't have enough ideas because, you know, and I don't want to waste that time. So please give me inputs and ideas. And I'll encourage you all, if you have any ideas, my email ID is available here. And so please send it to us so that we can, anything which comes to your mind, which is innovative, cutting edge, please do let us know for nation building. The last thing which I wanted to leave a thought with you was this introspection thinking which we are doing. Why we are a weak economy, you know, why we are 1/5 of China, or so one analysis we found was that all the major economies, a very large portion of that economy is big champion companies. So if you look at the US, 60-65% of their economy is big champion companies. And I don't have to mention the US companies to you. In the Fortune 500, you know, they would be having probably 250-500 companies. Do you know how many Indian companies are in the Fortune 500? Any idea? I think we have 6 or 7 or probably 9 companies, which is, I think, a very big weakness. So our large corporations are a very small portion of our economy. In Korea, it is probably 75% is the large corporations. So for India to become a leading economy of the world, we'll have to build big companies. And we'll have to build Indian champion companies also. When I told you about this movement of electronic manufacturing from US to Japan to Korea to Taiwan and then to China, if you remember, maybe you would have read about it, you won't remember, of course, is that a lot of manufacturing had moved to Philippines, Malaysia, Thailand also. But these countries never became big economies because they never had domestic champion companies, which Japan, Korea, and Taiwan, and now China have built very big, massive companies. So for India to become a glorious, large economy, I think that's a very important thing. As I started my talk to you, as I said, I will not be esoteric. I'll keep it very, you know, basic and very human. And I'm available if there are any questions in your mind. I'll love to field them and to interact with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for enriching us with such strong insights of the industry. We would like to request Mr. Suneet Vats, sir, to kindly address the gathering and encourage us.
Good afternoon, everyone. Distinguished guest on the dais, Mr. Pankaj, Mr. Orbin, Mr. Bhargav. I think as PD sir has rightly pointed out, and thank them not just for their time. I think today we as faculty and students will be able to, you know, learn a lot of, you know, and gather a lot of insights into what is being shared here. And that is the purpose of, you know, engaging with the stakeholder, which is very important to us as we go through the process of educating these young minds here. We take this opportunity, I think, to learn from you, sir, and I overheard possibly, if I have to say, and it's a really bad habit in terms of when he was talking to the chairman, Mr. Pankaj asked as to what, you know, is the reason for you to come up with an institution. When we started off in the year 2000, I think the idea behind having, and somewhere he mentioned in between about Mr. Modi that it was a divine ordained, it was truly a divine ordained, you know, meeting, because Chairman sir happens to be the disciple, initiated disciple of the Ramakrishna order, and he was in deep Himalayas with Swami Jitatmananji Maharaj, and this is where they thought of having something in the name of Swamiji in Delhi. Because why Swamiji? Because he's a right blend of, you know, philosophies, Eastern wisdom blended with Western science, and this is what Chairman sir always wanted, you know, to raise these students to the level where they, we contribute in nation building. I was in the morning reading a lot about IT sector, because and telecom for that matter, because then we have all the doyens from the same industry, the representing the same, and they have a bird's eye view of things happening. I just read about it, and I was asking Mr. Bhargav this morning that it is projected, though it is on a downturn now because of a lot of, you know, consolidation happening within the industry. I was asking him as to, you know, the 10 million jobs that have been projected in next 5 years are going to come at what levels. Fine, so top management would be what percentage of 10 million and so forth. Why is that insight important to us as an educational institution is because a lot of effort has been made in terms of, you know, getting the young minds and the young, India in fact happens to have the largest, youngest population in the world, and employment is going to be a big challenge before them. And it is something that we all, you know, as educational institutions wonder as to what are we going to do with you people. And this is where those insights from these three industry leaders would help us understand, tweak our, you know, curriculum in a way where we are able to offer certain value addition, you know, added courses to add to their knowledge, to make them more employable. I think that's where we would stand to gain from all of them. There's a 5-minute video on YouTube, I think as students of management studies and IT both should possibly go. It shares, you know, it's a time-lapse video which shows the top Fortune 500 companies and top 15, they're bracketed into top 15 finally, where it shows how companies, you know, have changed from 2000, and the names which were not even visible on the map have come up, you know, in terms of they're getting number one and number two positions. So Facebook, which was not even, you know, on the map in the year 2000, is now, you know, challenging the number one spot, and it keeps changing between Microsoft and so the kind of disruption that is happening all over, and the kind of might, I think China, we are concerned about China as well, because it's not just they're expanding their, you know, reach in terms of they're outsourcing a lot of earlier, there are a lot of jobs which used to come to, you know, the manufacturing which used to come to China because of low cost. They've started, you know, shifting it to Africa and countries like it, because the Silk Route revival that is happening now is something which is going to again change the landscape of the manufacturing sector that we have. I think I would not like to take much of your time, because I think we are here to hear our experts speak a lot about and share their insights. With those words, I would like to thank you all, and we welcome you once again, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your unbound knowledge with us. We would again invite Pankaj Mahindra sir to kindly proceed to and moderate the panel discussion.
Since you've already had too much of me, so I'll quickly move over to start with your principal director. My question is that what do you think are the major weaknesses which you find? You know, be very candid. What do you think are the major weaknesses in the student body? I mean, the body of students, not the president, etc. The whole body of students. If we have to become globally competitive.
Very difficult question, very frankly. But I think let me be as a professional talk about it. I don't think there's any weakness on the part of the students. Maybe our whole the ecosystem, we need to look at it because where the students are really working and we are really teaching it. We require a little more of coordination from all the stakeholders, institute, faculty, government, society, and the student body. Contrary to what people feel that this young generation, which is what we say categorized into rather whatever we are failing it, this generation is a very different generation looking for challenges. They look for and they are enjoying the world which Pankaji we mentioned is a VUSA world, which is a lot of volatility in the market happening, a lot of uncertainty happening in the market, lot of challenges of the complexity happening and also a lot of ambiguity. But they are the people who are able to make use of all that in a very effective manner. It's a question is of on our part, how really it is a big challenge on our part, how really to mold that in the direction. Maybe, as I said, the whole ecosystem, right from the very beginning in terms of the education, primary onwards, all we need to get into that part, not merely at the level of post-graduation. I like your idea, what you mentioned is the nationalist feeling in the Chinese students, which we need to not only inculcate, but also time and again, we need to re-emphasize that I think India needs to be great. Always we need to get into an idea, which is what a vice chairman also mentioned it with the chairman's that Eastern wisdom, this is very, very important. We should try to really get into that mode because once upon a time, India was what we say is a golden bird, and that is not only a golden bird. It was a country, one of the richest country, in fact, the world, and the other countries, they were nowhere in that. So probably we need to move in the direction, not specific weakness, but I think a big challenge, we need to move in the direction, right?
You know, teachers are always very emotional about their students, so that gives them little intellectual blinker on. So let me ask Arvind Bali, what are the employment trends now in the IT industry and the industry around it? And do you think institutions like these and the Indian education system is geared up to meet the challenges?
First of all, I must compliment the management. You've got a very good institute, very good management, and very good premises. And overall, this whole program has been organized in a very, very good manner. So really appreciate that. As far as employment, you know, as a student, you know, I think that is something which is always on the top of your mind. That we are doing this study, but ultimately, you know, like what will be our career, where we'll be growing. So first and foremost, I think today the trend is that education, because we have got a large population, so most of the people are educating their children, and you find that there are so many institutes. So education is becoming something very basic, which you all have to have. But more than the education, I think what is required is some special skill. You have to have some skill, you know, which ultimately which will be really recognized, which will be something liked by employers. There are two, three areas. I'll just like to give you example. For example, IoT is something which is going to grow in a big way. I think we should be working on that. Mobile app developments, this is something which is growth area of future. I think we should be working on that. But more than that, I was just seeing some data. Cyber security is one of the biggest concern which is coming world over, and world over there is a big requirement of cyber security experts. When I'm talking about cyber security, you all are aware that ultimately it is all now connected world. All of us are using computers, handheld device, any device, you know, anybody who is on internet is actually connected to the world, and when you are connected to the world, there are threats. And most of us know and believe that, you know, when we are talking about cyber security, it is something related to our credit cards or our wallet, you know, which we are using, that is something which is going to get affected with that. Believe me, you know, like that is just maybe just 5% or 7% of the whole universe. I think we should be more concerned about overall, you know, some of the areas. So give you just one or two examples. You have all seen Delhi Airport T3 terminal, you know. We all go to the terminal just maybe one and a half hour before our flight, and we see on the large screen, you know, like this is our like gate number, and we take boarding pass and we go to the gate. Now supposing, you know, some hacker just changes or does something mischievous over there, and flight which is going to Lucknow, which is actually supposed to be going from gate number 21, it puts it like it is going from gate number 42, and going to Mumbai is going 21, and ultimately, you know, like at the airport, what kind of chaos it will cause. And all these flights will be missed by people, there'll be thousands, 10,000, 20,000 people at one given time. If they miss their flight, what kind of ruckus it will create over at the airport. Same way, you know, like all this traffic management is all through electronics control systems. Now, supposing, you know, somebody starts playing with those lights, when it is supposed to be green, red, or red or green, that way, you know, like you'll have all the traffic jams. So anywhere and everywhere, wherever there are IT systems being used, whether it is banking or airlines or defense systems or anything, you know, like there is a possibility that there are hackers who are going to attack, and we have to have a lot of professionals in coming time who have to be taught how to really make your IT system safe and secure. So I think one area which I feel will be actually growing at a very, very fast pace for the next few years is cyber security, and I think that is an area where people should be concentrating.
Excellent, as always. Sandeep, the new generation, which we call it Generation X, I don't know why we call it Generation X. I would also like to know from you why we call it X, why not C or, you know, M or whatever. And, you know, what are the trends which you see in the telecom digital industry which is very positive?
So let me take a little forward, because we have alphabets A to Z. And a recent report from Forbes talks about Generation Z. So I'll not limit myself to X. And Z is, you can put it anything behind it, Zen, or they are the last fag end of the alphabet, so that's the ultimate, basically. So that's what the generation is there right in front of us, maybe born between the years of 1993 and 2007. That's where they have categorized that Generation Z is the one which is born in this period. So it's a period where you have a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of thoughts of innovation in there. So today, if you see, this is a very powerful generation. Very mobile savvy, I will say that way, not only just IT savvy, but mobile savvy. And there, in terms of spending power today, what these people have it is tremendous. One of the US studies talk about that their spending, direct spending power in the United States is around $24 billion currently, which can go up to $143 billion. And also indirect spending is almost $600 billion. So this generation is entirely different. They believe in innovation. They believe in quick decision making. Normally, when they go to a website or do a purchasing or do a decision making in today's times, I think they have statistically come out that there is an 8-second window available to these people to either perish or survive, either make it or break it, because that's their decision making is pretty fast. They have lots of options. They have a lot of thoughts behind it. So the companies today doing their work or targeting their sales or whatever the networks they create have to really take care of these kind of generation in mind. They have to be very, very innovative. Efficiency built in, speed is the essence of decision making in today's time. And they also have various platforms to work across. They can be on a tablet currently, or they can be on a mobile phone, they can be on a computer or any other device. So these are very, very, I will say, very knowledgeable, very much quick decision making, and they believe in trust. They do trust a lot. So since it's all digital, I think trust is the foremost part there, which has to be inbuilt into these kind of age as we move forward. So Generation Z is the word, Pankaj, nowadays. That's what I came recently across one of the articles of Forbes magazine. It talked about this, and I think that's the ultimate I can say in today's time.
Fantastic. You know, I was talking to a sort of inheritor of a very large business enterprise. He's 28 years old, and he's going to Wharton. So I said, you have such a big enterprise, and you have so much wealth. Why do you want to go and do an MBA now? So he said something very startling. He said, look, I want to build a network, a global network. And, you know, obviously that will multiply my wealth. So very insightful. And when I was asking the principal director this question, and I'll put this to the vice chairman now, that don't you think that in Indian institutions, not only here but across the country, I mean, FMS is one such institute, that we do not have a sort of variety of nationalities, which is, I think, the way forward. And I would like to come to this institute after 10 years and see a lot of more nationalities, because India is so diverse that we get drowned in the challenge of India. It's like a big continent. So this is what I'll want to leave a thought and want to hear your aspiration that, you know, when we come here after 10 years, we'll come here before that also, I'm sure. But after 10 years, how many nationalities do you think we'll have here?
Sunit. Thank you, Pankaji. I think I'll share one insight. I think what Pankaji was mentioning about is the person who went out to Wharton is wanting to go to Wharton. In fact, sir, in fact, I, you know, went last year to Columbia. I joined an executive program there. And everybody's intention there was networking. And why they are doing it, suddenly they're realizing that networks are worth more in terms of their capacity to deliver than, you know, to do anything which can be done intellectually or otherwise. It's not that they are not intellectually sound, but at the same time, yes, it requires a certain dynamic, a team dynamic, you know, to take things forward. So if you are well connected, I think that makes a very logical sense. Coming to the second part of the question, I think we have graduated from 18 years, the journey we have graduated and, you know, taken our own small steps towards achieving, first getting a NAC in A certification. We have gone in for an MBA accreditation as well. Last year we applied for autonomy. The reason for applying for autonomy was that, you know, at times you feel that the university that you are under is restrictive in its policies and, you know, outlook towards education. It has served a certain purpose, and unfortunately the kind of system that we inherit is not blaming the university, but at the same time, yes, it restricts you in terms of the courses that you can offer and the kind of nationalities that you can possibly entertain. So the diversity misses only because then the mandate provided by the university is such. And this is where we took a leap forward after having done, you know, step one and two in NBA and your NAC accreditation. We are now slowly moving in that direction so that we are able to spread out our wings much more. To add to what possibly, how are we going to deliver it, and do we have the deliverables with us? We have a great faculty strength here. It's not just the numbers that count, 300 in their PhD holders, but then we have big names like Professor I.M. Pandey and Professor Ratan Sir and so on and so forth. Our law department is headed by somebody who headed the Delhi Judicial Academy earlier. He was a chairperson there and has handled, you know, NLU portfolios and so forth. So we have the top team, you know, looking after it, and they are visionaries in their own spheres of, so I think hopefully when you come back next year or maybe next to next, we will be an autonomous college, and we'll possibly show you diversity in terms of, because then we will have the freedom to admit students of our choice. IP University restricts it to Delhi students, so the preference is given 85% to Delhi, which is again a great disadvantage for people sitting here, because then you're not able to have diverse views. So either we should have been given JNU status where they permit diversity more, and the criteria, admission criteria there itself is diversity. They encourage more diversity. So we'll move in those direction, and thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my views. Thank you.
You know, I want to leave another thought with you. In 1983, I got the highest salary which an MBA got in that year. Can you guess what was it? How much was it? In 1983.
Question
to all of you. Can you guess what was the highest salary which an MBA got in that year?
Any guess?
50,000 per?
2 years.
Per year or? Yeah, that's very close. Yeah, it was 3,700 rupees per month. So, and in that year, there was a big jump in salaries. Usually it was around 2,000. So we got a big jump in salary. So the point I'm making to you is, don't get dazzled by so-called Ivy League or starting salaries. They have no meaning. You know, do you know which college Sundar Pichai is from? Not any Ivy League. Which is Satya Nadella is from which college? And I can name hundreds of such. Rajiv Suri, who is the global CEO of Nokia. So it's all about, you know, when Deng started the opening of China, I told you how China grew. That's how a professional also grows. You know, you grow like this, and then some stagnate like this, and some just keep going like that. So it is the first 10 years where, you know, you have to build your sort of foundation, which is very important. I go back to Arvind Bali. Arvind, what do you think are the greatest challenges which, you know, the pass outs of this year are going to face in recruitment? Right? We know what is the condition of the telecom industry, for example. We've lost thousands and, you know, thousands and thousands of jobs. What are the challenges, you know? Are there geopolitical challenges? Are there opportunities which we have missed out and which you'd like to share with them?
Yeah, so this year will be a very different year. I think as far as the moment elections are over and we have the election results, I think there will be a surge which will be coming in the market. And with that surge, there will be a lot of job creation, which are really expected. So definitely last year was a bit slow, but I think this year onwards, things will be very different. Also, what I feel is that as far as jobs are concerned, you know, jobs will be again on the criteria, what is the special skill you have got? And I'm saying it again and again, because ultimately there has to be some unique quality. Some of you will be choosing development as a requirement. Now, you know, as a college has got a curriculum as per which they are teaching you. But besides that, how many certifications of your own you're doing? Like some of you would like to really go for digital marketing. Now there are some beautiful courses which are available on the internet or otherwise, you know, which you can do. If you can do it on the side with that, I think that makes your employment opportunities much better. So time is actually changing. You know, I'll just share something with you. You know, when we were in, when we were student, you know, we were just hearing at that time that in America or some of the European countries, they've got open book exams. You know, like you can just refer to the book. And it really used to sound so strange. You know, like how can you have an open book? Because ultimately you have to remember all those things and you have to do it. But today that time has come. Everything is available. I think entire knowledge is available to everyone. Today, you know, like most of the assignments that you'll be getting, they'll just tell you to do something and you have to just go to internet and search for it, and practically all the information is available. Now, how smart you are actually to comprehend that, how smart you are in presenting that, I think that is will be the difference. So ultimately, I think skills are going to make the difference. So you have to really learn. And I feel that as far as your opportunities are concerned, I will be very good in coming to 2 or 3 years' time. Next 2-3 years are going to be very good. And I think these batches will be definitely doing very well.
Fantastic. I want to ask the principal director that if you were the prime minister for academics, especially for institutes like this, what would be your greatest desire? And what would be the resources which, you know, you would require to turn them into, you know, top institutes in the world, world-class institutes?
Thank you very much. In fact, not a prime minister, but still I can think of. about this institute, I got a desire, in fact, a very intense desire, because I have been in the IIM system. I have been with the Manchester Business School. I have been in the university system. I have seen also the Indian private sector also, other than this. And therefore, I know as to what is happening in the education domain, what really things are. But we have got in VIPS certain qualities which we can always not only enhance, but we can reap and get into that, that strengthen it. We feel it, it has the potential to be one of the best, in fact, the institution, not only in India, but outside India, which is being sought after by every student. And that's what I feel very intensely about the institute, because we got everything that we look for it. Leaders, they are very competent, they have got a desire, in fact, they have a vision, they want to get into that part. We have resources, always limited ones, and that is what management really, as a professional, we feel it how really to tap those resources, even if they are limited, we should try to get into that. But most important part is that we are able to have a brand today, which is so great that everybody really looks towards the VIPS. So we can exploit that brand. That built brand has been built already over time by the visionary leadership. We already have it. It's a question of now moving forward in a different orbit altogether, and that is what we need to get into that. So I have got a very strong desire to move into a very different orbit, which is one of the topmost institutions, what not only in India but even outside. Right, thank you.
So we come to the most interesting part of the panel discussion, is that a question-answer session. We'll have a few because we have to close. So please shoot your question. If you want to address it to anybody particular in the panel, please mention that. Or if you want me to decide who should answer that, then give me that privilege. Yes. Were you acting in the movie Kesari? You
know, sir. And I don't even plan on going into the
Okay.
industry.
Okay.
Yeah, so my question, first of all, a very good morning to all the speakers and the chief guests. And my question would be for Mr. Sandeep. After the merging of Vodafone and Idea, I would like to know that what are the future possibilities which you are seeking in the telecom industry for Vodafone Idea Limited?
So first of all, thank you for the question being directed to me. I'm not the official spokesperson of the company. So inverted commas, all my personal responses. So definitely it's a challenging year for us because consolidation is happening, integration is happening, a lot of churn is happening because, as you know, for every role there are two people, from one from this company, from the other company. So that is happening, but definitely we have to move forward. And I just spoke about Generation Z, so we need a people lot to cater to that kind of a generation coming forward. So currently, for as far as we are concerned, I think we have a lots of scope in digital marketing in the organization. Apart from the regular roles you have for networks, network operation, maintenance, security, and all that stuff, but that's one niche area. I think we are still open and having people on board, because as we move forward, the direction is getting more stringent. We move into new areas like 5G, for example, a lot of application and use cases will come forward. So I think we still need a lot to cater to that kind of a technology change.
Yes, please. Gentleman on the right. Beards are becoming very fashionable, I'm saying. I think it's Virat Kohli is the, yeah.
Very good afternoon to all, sir. My question is for you, sir. Recently, we are coming up with the 5G technology and a lot of big players in the market, like US and all, they are planning to ban Huawei, as we all know. So what's India's take on this? Where are we?
That's a very difficult question to answer, but I'm obliged to answer it. So I think India is equidistant. We will not come under any global pressure or any US pressure. We will have the best national interest in our policy making. We are studying that is there any security concern, a genuine security concern, which ITU has said that there does not seem to be. So I think India will take its independent call. We will be equidistant from both US and China in our economic policy and security policy.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. So what you've told us a while ago, I wanted to ask you that you mentioned the 5-point system that China followed some 30 years ago, three decades ago, that led to the huge success or it becoming one of the superpowers of the world. What, according to all of you, would be the 5 points that would make our country lead a better future for all of us, if that includes us or other people from the other sectors or the other areas? What are those 5 points according to you? What are the ideal 5 points?
I'll mention only one, which is education. When we went to a particular state and a very large investment was coming in which could have employed 25, 30,000 people, I asked the Chief Minister that we are planning to have a plant at this particular location. Can you tell me within 100 kilometer radius how many rural girls are educated beyond class 10th and 12th in second division? And you will be startled by the answer. There were villages in which there not even one single young girl had cleared 10th class. They had all left in 6th, 7th, 8th. So I think the first thing is that, which is something beautiful which Kerala and Tamil Nadu have been able to do, where India is failing desperately. You know, the workforce in Tamil Nadu is 36% women. And Bihar, can you guess how much is it? It's about 9%. So it's a very desperate gap. The first thing we have to do is that girls have to be educated up to high school. And that should be mandatory. And this is the most number one achievement of Mr. Modi, that he was able to change this in Bihar, in Gujarat. There is almost universal education for girls there. So I think I'll just say this. This is one thing India should go after relentlessly. And my colleagues will say that.
Yeah, so I'll say that this definitely is the most important. Second is, I think discipline is very, very important. We are a democracy and definitely we cannot follow what happens in China. But I think one biggest difference that we find between China and India is, I think the discipline levels are so different. In India, I think we all start respecting the law. We start respecting overall society. I think it'll change us. For example, when we are in any public areas, if on roads, etc., we have to respect the red lights. Same way, you know, like we have to keep the country clean. Also, you know, we should be honest to ourselves so that, you know, as a person, we are able to contribute to the nation. Today, you know, most of us have become selfish because of historic reasons. I think we have seen thousands of years with struggle, and most of the time we have become self-centered. If we have become nation first and then us, so I think things will change. And nation first means, you know, anything which is for others, like society, environment, where you're living, even the organization where you're working, if you start giving weightage to that, I think the things will be very different.
Okay, so Sandeep, you.
So I think adding on to what Pankaj said and what Arvind said, I think legitimacy of whatever you do is very important. You would have seen a lot of media reports talking about GST and demonetization in the past. I think both factors have helped the country a lot, though there may be a debate on both, but my view and what I have gathered across, say for example, GST today. So GST, initially there were teething troubles, but the way business has adopted GST, today they are happy. Small and medium businesses are happy because everything is getting legitimate. His supply chain back forth and forward is getting legitimate. So their businesses, their turnovers are getting recognized. So even they are getting an appetite to grow their businesses further more. While they were doing a cash business, none of the banking institutions recognized, okay, your turnover is say XYZ. Today their turnover is recognized, they have a more appetite, the bankers and the lenders are offering them more money, okay, you do more. So over a period of time, doing a legitimate business result into a lot of things which are important for their businesses, for the country as a part. Like you collect legitimate taxes, you give back to the government, you do it for the social cause. So when you need money for the society, for example, education, health, and all other sectors, where does the money come from? So if you get this collection, which was reported more than 100 lakh crores, 1 lakh crores in the last month, I think you see an increasing trend, and you all will benefit. All citizens would benefit, and we talk of the nation first, as Arvind said, I think that becomes a true story. We do a legitimate business, bring in transparency, honesty in the businesses, I think we can prosper a lot. Like you go to Europe or any other countries in overseas, they don't understand the business of cash and check. In India, we only understand cash mein le lo ya check mein kar lo. There, everything is digital. Most of things is digital. You spend a euro or a dollar, you can use a credit card and pay it. You go to Chandni Chowk, they don't understand what is card, what is Paytm, what is check. So doing a legitimate business, I think, brings an entire game changer scenario for the nation, and that can benefit all of us.
Sir.
I know, I just mentioned, in addition to what I think these experts have mentioned, we have got a trust deficit in ourselves. We don't trust ourselves. We feel we can't beat China. We can't be like US. In case we are able to do it. If we have a conviction that we can do it, we can do it. If we feel we cannot, we cannot. This is the basic, fundamental, primary principle that we have to have it. With this, I think this is very important. Right, thank you very much.
I think beautiful point. And he's not mentioning that you be egoistic. Just be confident about yourself, because ego is the biggest killer. And 1 minute
contribute. 5 points, is it? I think it's a kind of a subset. I think I will only be building on the perspective that has already been built up. I think education, yes, is very important for this country. But then, as I think I would get more convinced with Ratan sir, and I was possibly I have written down that point only, that we need to have, you know, the courage to dream big and, you know, move as a country, you know, realizing that we have the potential to be what we want to be, and we will be there no matter what. So I think that's the biggest, you know, lesson to be learned. And the charactership of our citizenship would decide where this nation would head in times to come. So I think that's my take on it, sir. Thank you.
Yes, anybody else, please? Yeah, the gentleman at the back. Also with a beard, yes.
Good morning to all of you, sir. My question is that, as we all know, 33% of US doctors are Indians. And in Microsoft also, there are most of the software engineers are Indians. My question is that why they are migrating to outer countries? Why not India? Why they are not practicing in India?
I think that should not be, I don't think this is so appropriate, because I think we labor market should be very open, and it should, where the balance is, you know, water finds its own level. So people who want to go out and who want to get higher salaries, etc., it's not a question of nationalism. But let me give you a positive spin to this. We are doing a very remarkable project on AMOLED. Now, AMOLED and OLED, you know the difference between the two technologies. compared to the normal backlight which is there in televisions. So when a television or a mobile is sold to you that it has AMOLED, you pay a higher price. Because there you don't have a backlight, the picture appears on the product. The inventor of this technology is not from Samsung or LG, it's from Kodak Labs, and he's an Indian, Dr. Rajeshwaran. So now there is a sort of emotional deficit in these people who are there who want to come and contribute that to India. So I think that process has now started. One of the reasons why China became very powerful was that the Chinese who are working in the US, in the universities, in the institutions there, came back to China and contributed to China. And I think that trend is happening. So I'm kind of reversing your question or, you know, spinning it on its head by saying that it's a very big asset we have and we should make sure that people come back and contribute to the nation.
So I think further adding on to that, one is, you know, like as a nation, you know, we are having a lot of population, youngsters are coming. So in a way it is good also, like a lot of opportunities will be coming world over, and our students, they should fill those positions. But definitely there is a reverse trend already happening in the world. You know, when we passed out, a lot of our classmates, they went abroad. And that time, you know, like difference between them and us was very, very large. Today, you know, like a lot of them, they come back and then they talk that things have flipped, you know. Today, quality of life is much better in India. Money at higher position is much better. They all already have started feeling that. And also, you know, the new startups, a lot of new startups are either by youngsters or it is the people who are coming back from those countries. So as Pankaj was saying that in China it has happened, in India also we are seeing a lot of people in Bangalore, India, like NCR, they are all people who have come back from those countries.
Fantastic.
Thank you, sir, for your golden views.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, first of all, a very good afternoon to all the dignitaries. My question is that, sir, what is the major advice you would like to give to us? What can we do to be successful like you? What is your advice to new, like, students like me who want to start their own startup or do something on their own? What is your biggest advice to them?
No, thank you for claiming that we are successful. I still think there's a long way to go. I sort of acknowledge that it's my generation which has brought India to 1/5 of China's per capita income. So I think we are not that successful. We have a long way to go. So I don't think we have one particular advice. There is a lot of this thing, but I'll take a cue from my last input to you when the principal director was answering her question and giving input. I think the biggest killer I find is ego, because you see, as they say in our philosophy, Hindu philosophy, that, you know, you have Paramatma, which is the universe, and you have your Atma, the soul, and you have the power of the universe if you don't have the ego in between. So always be hungry for learning, you know, don't have a chip on your shoulder. And, you know, try to kill the ego in yourself. That would be my advice. Yeah.
No, no, I think just to add, learning is every day for us. Even we learn it every day. So I never think that our learning has stopped. Every day, and I'm happy to learn from anybody, maybe my junior, senior, peer, or whosoever it is, I think you learn. So learning never stops. The moment you think that learning is stopped, then you are gone.
Thank you. Should we have it? Thank you very much. I think it was
Thank
very
you,
interesting.
And good questions.
And good, very, very good questions, yes.
Thank you, sir.
We would like to thank all the dignitaries for such an intriguing panel discussion.
Varuna Rajan sir of our institute have created an automated electronic lamp for lamp lighting ceremony, and we would like to invite them for the demonstration.
Thank you, sir. Now to present a vote of thanks, we would like to call our Dean, Professor Dr. Supriya Madan. A very good afternoon to the distinguished dignitaries on the dais and one and all. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose this vote of thanks. Thanks on the occasion with such powerful energy speakers. Thank you for sharing your valuable time and rich insights. I take this opportunity to express my gratitude to Mr. Pankaj for his esteemed presence and valuable thoughts. Your concerns about the hard facts are well taken. We also hope to witness India being the number one mobile phone manufacturing industry in the world. Thank you for sharing your email ID, sir. We will definitely share our ideas and innovations very soon with you. Thank you for that. I thank Mr. Sandeep for giving insights. It was truly inspiring to learn from you. I would like to thank and acknowledge the gratitude to Mr. Arvind Bali, sir. For sharing your experiences with us. You truly are well inspired by giving us an insight on the new technologies and skill sets required, like IoT, mobile computing, digital marketing. We are doing a little bit to inculcate these extra skill sets for our students. Your concerns about vulnerability of security is very well taken, and we are also trying to inspire our students to take these technologies ahead. I would like to take this opportunity to place on record my heartfelt thanks to our principal director, Professor Ratan Sharma, sir. It has been his mastermind for organizing this event. Dr. Rashmi Tanwar, we thank you for taking the initiative and your active participation in bringing together this galaxy of eminent speakers with us. We are blessed to have the eternal support and guidance of the management always, and this is why at WIPS we are able to achieve success in all our endeavors. I cannot thank the management, I know they are with us always. Events like this cannot happen overnight. The wheel started rolling months ago. It required planning and the bird's eye view for details. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of motivated and dedicated colleagues and students, and they have done a great job. I extend my thanks to all of them for their enormous cooperation in emerging and making this event a great success. Dear Gen Z, not Gen X anymore, knowledge is infinite, and therefore the quest for learning
should be perpetual. This is what has been said, the last line. The best preparation for tomorrow is by doing your best today. Don't wait. The time will never be just too good. While we are preparing, postponing life, time continues. So with these words, I thank all of you for being here. I thank you all, sir, again. And we wish to see you not in 10 years, but very soon with us. We will wait for your guidance and your presence very soon. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I would now request all the dignitaries to kindly proceed to the studio.
And we thank you all for being an avid audience. Thank you.